I'm gonna go behind the curtain a little. The way I typically read my webcomics is I read them on my iPad when I'm laying in bed. This way I can dedicate all my time and energy to the comic without being distracted by music, videos, and people yelling at me, which is an often occurrence. Now originally I wanted to read and review Dominic Deacon, but for some odd reason that comic site is so poorly optimized for iPad that it will take damn near a full minute to load a single page. So if anyone know any alternative sites I can read this comic on, please let me know. But anyway, because I couldn't read that comic, I went to the next comic on my list, and seeing webtoons now fall under my jurisdiction, I fired up the webtoons app on my iPad. Now I'm just gonna use this opportunity to talk about this app. This is a really good app. It's fast, it's fluid, it's incredibly easy to find what you're looking for. I mean, it even suggested my boy Lautaro's comic, Wondergeist, that you should totally go read. And all of its push messages are tailored to each individual comic that it's pushing, which is really nice and makes you actually interested in checking the comics out. Actually, I love this app. So Webtoon, if you want to sponsor an episode or two, call me. As much as I love this app, there's one thing. The only thing I don't like is, well, the comments that I'm forced to go past to click to the next page. Now, part of the reason why I hate that is because the people in the comments will sometimes outright spoil the comic you're reading, or there are these really dumb and or immature comments. Like, try and read a comic where there's any sort of love triangle and you'll feel yourself recall back with some of the shit these people say. Like, some of this is the most basement dweller I once brushed up against a girl so we're practically a couple now bullshit I've ever seen. For example, I was reading a comic called Dice where one of the comments was literally, "What? She didn't kiss him? I hope she fucking dies!" Like, fucking what? Anyway, sorry, I just had to get that off of my chest. Today we're reviewing a webtoon that's been suggested by a lot of people ever since I first started covering webtoons called Tower of God. It's a webtoon written and drawn by Lee Yong-kui under the pen name Xiu, which is short for Slave in Utero, whatever that means, and was started back in 2010 as the first part of a universe called the Talse Uza. It's been a huge success online and is being read by nothing short of 5 million people on a weekly basis. And boy are those people gonna be pissed, cause while this comic might be considered great by a lot of people and getting a ton of good reviews and a lot of views, I actually have a lot of issues with it. The story of Tower of God follows the character 25th Knight. Yes, that is the actual literal translated name. But most people just call him Bam. Bam here has been magically transported to the Tower of God, which is a big tower. Don't worry, I'm being vague for a reason here. In this tower, he wishes to find his one and only friend, Rachel, and as of such, has to travel up the tower to find her to be with her, despite it being clear from the very get-go that Rachel left Bam behind intentionally.
Fucking friend-zoned again? All ladies are sluts!
The tower is separated into various gigantic levels, so big in fact that entire cities are made on each level. To progress to the next level, one must pass a test that is equal in difficulty to the level they are currently on. These tests can vary from being a test of skills, cunning, strength, speed, and even luck. You pass the test, and you send up a level. While Bam is venturing up the tower, however, he quickly gets entangled in a story about the king of the tower, Jihad, and his powerful daughters and their equally powerful weapons. There's also a subplot thing about Jihad having sent assassins to kill one of his daughters, but it got introduced and after over 50 chapters, it still hasn't been brought up again, even a little, so either Xiu is playing the long game, or he straight up forgot.
When I'm done with this review, I think you guys will know which one I think is the case.
Believe it or not, I actually love a good death game story. Darwin's Game, The King's Game, Gantz, High-Rise Invasion, Alice in Borderland, 999, Virtue's Last Reward, As the Gods Will, Rabbit Doubt, Exam, Battle Royale, the first Saw movie, and not fucking Danganronpa, get that absolute weak shit out of here! But yeah, I actually like a good death game story. I kinda adore the whole juxtaposition of playing with someone's life and putting it in the most innocent setting ever, being a game. Seeing these ordinary people and how they have to deal with their life hanging in the balance and what it does to their psyche and thought process is really interesting. And seeing them do all this clever planning and roundabout thinking to sort out how to beat what would otherwise be a simple game is always really cool. My favorite being where they themselves interpret the rules and overcomplicate it when the answer is actually right in front of them and is simple. I like those games cause they play on how we humans think, feel, act, and the game actually takes a backseat and becomes the rules of which the participants operate in. No matter what happens, the rules are the same, they're strict, and the participants will use these rules to their utmost limits to either win the game or sabotage it for others. This is, by the way, why I hate Danganronpa, cause it plays fast and loose with those rules. And this is also why I don't like the tests in Tower of God.
Long segue, I know, but here we are.
Tower of God, in terms of premise, could hardly be any stronger. The idea of having to venture up to the top of an unrealistically huge tower in order to get a wish granted, and that you, in every sense of the word, will be tested on every floor, is a goldmine to build a story around, and has so much potential to work with. The mere fact that it's a tower and you start from the bottom already limits the participants to only go one way, making it so the reader immediately wonder what's at the end of this road. This plays with us people's need for closure. We need to find out what's at the other end. This, accompanied with the world inside the tower, and outside for that matter, is something alien to both the reader and the protagonist, makes it even more interesting to journey through this one-way street. Plus, when the tower is so gigantic that people can actually live within cities, makes it all kinda epic. It's like the Tower of Babylon. So take all of that and add the whole death game aspect to it that I love, and you pretty much should have the best thing in the world, in my opinion. And what did we get?
We kinda get a crossbreed between a battle comic and a death game comic that sort of functions a lot like Whose Line Is It Anyway, where the rules are made up and the points don't matter.
Now, before I continue, I don't want you to think this comic is inherently bad. It's actually pretty good. The pace at which it moves forward and the premise alone makes it a really good comic that stands out, and there's twists and turns all the way up the tower that honestly made it hard to put the comic down. So let me get this out there before I start complaining. Do go read Tower of God. It's an exciting read and you'll be thoroughly entertained all the way through. I honestly think you'll love this comic unless you're a reviewer or a critic, cause I'll be real, while you get a great looking tower, if you look at the individual pieces that makes the tower, you'll find that these building blocks are really, really flawed. And there are so many small little issues all the time that I could almost do a read through much akin to Les Linders, Yosh, and Rascals.
I'm not gonna, cause this bitch is long as shit. But I am gonna talk about various things that while reading it just annoyed the shit out of me, and why. And I'm gonna start with the tower.
The story takes place in a big tower. We only know this because we've been told this. We never see what the world outside the tower looks like. Sure, it can be used as a shocking reveal later or near the end, but it doesn't really do a lot for the plot. How big is the tower? What is the world like outside of it? Why do people want to go into the tower? How's the tower constructed? Now, this might be considered nitpicky stuff, but it is the entire driving force of the comic's narrative, and we know nothing about it. It's big, it's parted into floors, and if you get to the top, you get a cookie. Oh, and it's being run by some king. That's it! You read over 100 chapters of the comic, and you will know about this much.
But, I hear you ask, does this really matter? And yes, yes it does.
We hear people are actively entering the tower, but the games inside of it will most likely lead to their death. The second fucking test of the tower alone has over 50 of the 100 participants die in one department, and 97 people die out of 100 in another department. So what's the living situation like outside the tower for them to actively warning to go inside? What's so bad outside that people would rather test their luck against these terrible odds that could lead to death than surviving outside the tower? It's not enough to just say the tower is there, especially when the tower is both the biggest antagonist of the comic but also the MacGuffin. It is what drives the entire comic and it's been given so little screen time that it's ridiculous. Like, we get these awful description boxes about techniques and strategies that serves nothing to the overall story other than adding a little sprinkle of trivia here. But we can't hear how wide a floor is. Is it a cylinder or is it a square? Is it a time cube? Like, what the fuck? If it's so freaking important, why the fuck do you not explain anything about it? And sure, it might at first be to put the reader in the same situation as Bam, who knows nothing about the tower, but Bam quickly gets friends and allies who clearly seem to know what's going on, and he never bothered to ask any questions.
The issue with not telling us a lot about the tower is that we are then forced to assume that the tower is not that important if they don't bother telling us stuff about it. But the issue is that we all know that it is super important. And if any of you tell me that, oh, you could just have found that out by going to the Wikipedia page, fuck you, learn to write a story.
If you have read Tower of God, you might be sitting there and yelling at me that the entire story does in fact not center around the tower, but about Bam chasing Rachel. And here's the problem. Rachel wants to get to the top of the tower. Bam wants her to get to the top of the tower. The drama that happens in the comic and between these characters are because they wish to reach the top of the tower. So yes, it does indeed center around the tower. Which brings me to another problem I have about the tower. How big is it? I feel this is kind of vital because, well, if it's this big epic tower with its own housing, cities, lakes and oceans and shit, it's gotta be pretty huge, right? Like, Siu clearly wants to make this tower as epic as possible, and I am all in for that. I love it. I'm so down. I'm pumped! I want to be blown away by how outrageously huge this tower is. And then, here comes the Rangers. Rangers are people who are like the referees and judges when it comes to tests. They're also working as teachers for a weird segment that show up, but anyway. Now, you're apparently only able to become a Ranger if you reach the top of the tower. Now, there's a lot of Rangers. Heck, there's an entire organization on each floor of them. And with every single Ranger we see, the coolness of the tower just dies a little more. Really? The tower is so small that so many people have gotten to the top? And if they can get their wish granted no matter what, if they reach the top, did everyone just wish to become a Ranger? Why? For what reason? If the sky is the limit, why do you simply wish for a job? Like, it doesn't even seem like such a hard task to do anymore when so many people have done it. The tower's size gets even more lessened when a character explains that through the entire tower there's 7 big workshops. Really? Only 7? Big epic tower 7 workshops. I can think of skyscrapers that have more tech departments in them.
It sort of feels like Seer wanted this big epic tower but didn't go crazy enough with it. So we're left with what most of all feels like if you were playing Shadow of the Colossus and the biggest colossi was The Rock Dwayne Johnson.
The other segment I wanted to cover of this comic is its pacing. Credit where it's due. I actually love the comic's pacing as a whole. There are a few times when I feel the comic spends way too long on explaining a game or something, but other than that, I think the comic's pacing is great. Stuff is always happening, you're always invested, and there's always something new just around the corner. So, in a large scale, the pacing works, but if you look at it in a slightly smaller scale, it's not great at all. In fact, this may be my biggest issue with the comic all in all, and it is that Seal was in too much of a rush, it seems. Let me break it down for you. At the beginning of the comic, Bam passes a test and is sent to the floor above. The rest of the comic season takes place on this floor. There's a lot of different tests, but it's all on the same floor. In fact, the season ends just as they get to the next floor. Throughout the season, the comic becomes less about advancing up the tower and about a whole lot of other bullshit. It becomes a battle comic of sorts, it becomes about Jihad and why he's an asshole, it becomes about his daughters and their weapons, it becomes about traitors within the ranks of the tower and much more. This is the second floor. It is only the second floor. The comic doesn't ease you into this shit either. It becomes very clear, very fast, that this is now a battle comic, and fuck you if you were interested in the promise that was set up to begin with. If you want an example of this, how many tests do you see after the door test that is somehow winnable by brute force alone. It almost feels like something is missing, like there were some flaws where Bam or him and his group could go do some tests, and here you could have had some info about the tower dumped on us, have some character development or something, help us get our bearings like Bam. Like, at least set up the status quo before you break it.
Like, at this pace it feels like starting off a book with, and then X happened.
The issue with this pace can also be seen in the test, which is another thing I want to talk about. The tests are, as stated before, trials that the participants has to go through to access the next level of the tower. The first task that Bam gets is unreasonably hard, which is also stated by some spectators. So you'd think the next floor would be a cakewalk for him, seeing he aced this one, but no. Again, this could have been done with some more floors in between the two we've shown, to show how Bam slowly builds up to reach the level he managed to pass to begin with. But anyway. Again, with the test, there's some signs that Seo was kind of in a rush. If the tests are not just straight up fighting and murdering each other, they're trials where one's wits are tested. These tests of wits are right from the get-go something where you kinda have to think outside of the box. Again, I would probably personally have preferred if we had gotten some tests where the people had to think inside the box to then show them think outside of it. Like I mentioned in my Cloud Scratcher review where I used the example of the three pigs and the wolf. It's because of the two first picks that we are able to appreciate the success of the third. And this is just something Seo doesn't do. There's nothing that these things can change from. This wouldn't be nearly as bad if this was all, but I just audibly started groaning each and every fucking time a rule or something was changed, added, or straight up ignored on the fly. I will even go as far as to say there's more tests like that then there's tests that are run legitimately. Heck, even the first test is like this, where it just changed on the fly. Again, no status quo has been established for us to appreciate or marvel at the change.
I'm kind of reminded of the KSI versus Logan Paul fight, you know, the boxing thing, where they were both like trying to do these big knockout punches instead of trying to set it up with a couple of jabs. And just like that fight, this comic ends up looking like a freaking idiot. What year is this? 2019? Fuck it, I'm topical!
The last thing, and then I promise we'll move on, is Season 2. Any issue and problem I might have with Season 1, you can rest assured that in Season 2, they are amplified by a million. I fucking hate Season 2. It was a miserable reading experience. It was a perfect amalgamation of all the issues I had with the comic just mashed together into this Frankenstein monster of having no identity. We even follow a new protagonist, and no, we still don't get any new information about the tower, which would be a perfect time to give them to us. While I can admit some of the season 1's issues comes from looking at the comic too closely, season 2 is just straight up bad. Like, it's real bad. It's fucking bad. Heck, season 1 might even be much better than I remember, and season 2 has just tainted my memory of the comic as a whole. It's so fucking terrible, it's like it's been written by someone completely different. Almost every single goddamn chapter, it filled with so many plot holes, so many contrivances, so many inconsistencies, so many ass pulls, so much of the shit I've complained about before turned up to a fucking 11. At least season 1 got better as it went, but season 2 just got worse and worse and worse, and when I finished season 2, I audibly said out loud, "Fuck you," because I felt insulted by the comic. It's gone full on battle comic, with no illusion that it's trying to be anything different. So much so that people are being measured by freaking power levels at one point, and have special techniques with unique names. The comic tries to claim certain things, but people who paid attention when reading it will find it drastically conflicting with other stuff that was said earlier. The comic tries to set up certain new things about what it's like living in a tower, but doesn't do a good enough job at it, then it ends up becoming retarded. Like fucking... Okay, a toddler is taking the test to go up the tower now. A toddler! Remember people die in these trials? 20 floors below this one, the participants were fighting a beast at the size of Godzilla. And even should this toddler win, which of course she does, cause fuck you, what's gonna happen to her? Like, let's pretend she didn't get picked up for a team. Was the toddler just gonna start a new life on the new floor? Cause remember, there's no communication by the common man between the floors. You can't just venture up and down all willy-nilly. Once you're at the new floor, you're just there. How irresponsible are the parents to just send a kid to take these tests grown-ass men has failed and died to do? Well, sure, she has an escort, but what if they had to kill each other? Sorry, kid, guess you got fucked now. Also, if you do venture up to the next floor and can't return back down legally, what about your possessions? How do you find a place to live? Do you have money? How do you get a job, food, clothes, a bath? Is this provided for you? How do you make it circulate with money? Cause it clearly isn't on the floor season 2 starts at, cause the protagonist is in so much debt that he is an inch away from being skinned alive and have his organs harvested. A very mature and dark thing for this comic that can't show wounds, by the way.
Okay, listen. I would rather read an entire story on the cat box than I would read season 2 of Tower of God. I am dead fucking serious.
All in all, the writing of Tower of God isn't great. In fact, it's kinda sorta terrible. But I feel it's only if you actually sit and, you know, think about it. If you just toggle your brain off and go with the flow, the comic is entertaining, if not annoying as fuck with its too liberal uses of the word jerk. It's dramatic, it's tense, and honestly, you do feel excited to see what each new test and how people get through it. That is, if you understand the rules in the first place, but I ranted for long enough. So, if you are a person who just wanna read something stupid and toggle your brain off, then by all means. But if you are a person who can't do this, who dares to ask questions, even a little, the comic will punish you for it. It will punish you, it will hurt you, it will make your reading experience a fucking nightmare.
Kinda feels like Dragon Ball or Final Fantasy in that regards, where you just have to unplug your brain, shut up, and don't think. I said don't think! Motherfucker, I told you not to fucking think! I will blow a fucking hole in your face!
One last thing that's come up while working on this review is that apparently there's no real plan to answer any of the issues I have and will bring up later. In fact, you will have to go and read a freaking Wikipedia. I cannot state enough how bad this is for storytelling. Again, they can have those weird boxes for obscure techniques and strategy names that will never come up again, but not give any world building. Like, during my time talking with a huge fan of this comic, Ronin, he disclosed that Kun is like 400 years old. This is something you'd only know if you read the Wikipedia. Also, how Jahad became a king is apparently common knowledge in this world, but hey, if you wanna know this, bitch, you better read the wiki. Forcing your readers to seek alternative media to understand your media is in every sense of the word bad storytelling. A wiki isn't bad per se, cause it's good to keep track of all the info you get, but maybe disclose it in the story first and then compartmentalize it in a wiki after that.
It kind of feels like the opposite end of the spectrum of where Unsounded is, where Unsounded would give you way too much world building, and then you have Tower of God, which will give you nothing to an almost frustrating level.
Right off the bat, let me just come out and say I originally didn't like Bam's design. I liked how the red was his dominant color and stayed consistent, but I wasn't keen on his face and his hair. He looked dull and bland and rather unremarkable. So imagine my surprise when they straight up just changed it and boom, suddenly I was much more happy with it. Like, sure, he is your typical boy hero protagonist we know from these comics with his messy bed hair and all, and yes, he still looks like a girl, something the comic even brings attention to itself, but it was still a great change to see. It felt more compact in a sense, like less flair and more concise. And then they changed it again for the age skip for season 2, and I was again back to hating it. I swear, after the time skip, you can count on one hand the amount of times Bam isn't standing with his hair down in front of his eyes. Even when we know for a fact that this is Bam, they still hide his face from us. Like, fucking why?
Like, I don't think the people who didn't immediately go, "Oh, hey, that's Bam," are even capable of, you know, thinking.
The designs as a whole of the comic are pretty great. There's something interesting in seeing people in old samurai robes with swords and sandals, standing next to a guy with a sniper rifle, jeans and a t-shirt. Again, a thing that makes you wish more info was given about the comic's universe as a whole. Plus, major kudos to Zeev, cause they must have designed a billion people at this point, cause there's so many characters that just shows up with great designs, only to lose a test and then not being able to ascend the tower. There is one problem though, and that is that if you want to really get a good look at these characters, you will have to wait.
Because at first, instead of getting this, you're getting this.
So much of the early strips of this comic is spent on being all up in the characters' faces and other body parts. And I really don't understand why. Cause this isn't a good look. Not only does it confuse you sometimes with what the different characters are reacting to, but when you get close-up of their faces, you would expect it was to show their emotions and feelings while they're reacting to something. But then you see their faces and... Jesus, are they mediocre at best. Sure, every now and then, Zeev will manage to showcase the character emote really well and you will immediately understand what emotion they're portraying, right? But the vast majority of it, it just looks like everyone's bored or tired and are kinda half-assed acting. They're straight up people who has their teammate either straight up murdered or knocked out in front of them, and they look about as shocked and terrified as they would if someone put on Nickelback at a party.
Can you not?
The presentation of Tower of God is also a weirdly mixed bag. Kasiu does great things in terms of presenting stuff with how the panels are laid out. Important scenes are given big frames, there's intentionally left big gutters to build up suspense, and sometimes Zeev uses the vertical format to tell stuff through visual storytelling. So a round of applause for that.
You did it, good job, I can't believe it, I'm proud of you.
But, and this becomes incredibly prevalent in season 2, then there's his action shots. Now, sometimes these are straight freaking baller, as my mother used to say. Seeing Rag leaping down onto a monster the size of a battleship is given so much love and care in presentation, and it really serves to highlight just how cool it is. And then there's the other times where you just can't for the life of you see what happens. Like, what the fuck is this? Can you tell this USB stick is being grabbed again? What the fuck is even going on here? These scenes are littered across the comic, and it's so weird because time and time again, Zeev proves they can make excellent fight scenes, and then other times they are completely ass at it. Also, gotta be said, unless this is some Korean thing, this pose is just wrong.
If he's trying to do karate, he's trying to do what's known as a gedanbirai, which is a low block and a stance, where you are sweeping in your leg and your arm to block a low incoming attack, and then you have your fist at the ready to punch your opponent. If you move it around like an idiot, you will be all up in his shit and you can't reach properly cause your leg is just as far out as your fist.
It cannot be overstated how much of a mixed bag the presentation of this comic is. Again, season 1 does it somewhat well, even if it has the issues with the art being a little shaky and things being too close for comfort. But season 2 is just fucking... Like, the entire part 1 of season 2 is ridiculous. Suddenly, characters that were never shown appears to be part of a game. Where were they? Who are they? Why are we never introduced to them before this? And just this entire thing with hiding Bam's identity. Like, everyone can tell it's Bam. You know it's Bam. I know it's Bam. A blind person from down the street would know it's Bam. But he keeps hiding his face and have him not talking. I heard it's because we're supposed to question why he's doing what he's doing, but they have a big epic reveal where we see his face for the first time when someone calls him Bam. So it's like, no, it was obvious they were trying to keep it a secret who he was, but the build up to the reveal is so long and is so poorly done that everyone can tell who it is from the get go.
Hey guys, guess who I am? You will never guess it. I'm Jason Statham. That's what my dating profile says. I never get a second date.
Now, who in here likes time skips in comics? I know I do. It's always so cool to see characters we know and love grow and not only see what they're up to, but also see what they look like. I remember when I was a kid and I was reading Dragon Ball, every time they would go to the martial arts tournament after a time skip, I was always super eager to see how the different characters looked. As stated before, there's also a time skip or two in Tower of God, and you'll be happy to know that some of the signs do change a little. Not a lot. In fact, it's worrying how little changes in 6 fucking years. The character Kun is the only one who actually looks like any time has passed because he looks older, but Bam just looks the same but with longer hair. This is made even dumber by the fact that Kun is over 400 years old according to the Wikipedia. So how does that make sense? Do you spend 400 years looking like a teenager and then there's just this weird 6-year gap where you suddenly age? Like, really? Even Rachel looks almost exactly like she did before the time skip. Don't get me wrong, there are some design changes here and there, and Zero does become a much better artist from start to the end of the comic, but I just feel these changes are just not big enough. 6 years is a long freaking time. I mean, as of making this video, that whole 2009 versus 2019 meme is going on, where people are sharing pictures of themselves with 10 years in between, and they look nothing alike. Or you can look at the funny pictures where people talk about what has happened between when Kingdom Hearts 3 was announced to now that it has finally come out. 6 years is a long fucking time! Anyway, the point remains that I can imagine a lot of people were, like me, disappointed in seeing just how little had changed in such a massive time skip. I mean, we've seen bigger changes in comics that only had 2 years of time skips. It becomes extra silly when another 2-year time skip happens between part 2 and 3 of season 2, and the fucking toddler I was talking about before still looks like a goddamn kid. You got any idea how fast you grow when you are a kid and how big a difference 2 years can make?
Heck, I got a sister in Sweden that I only ever see like half a year apart, and I hardly ever recognize her when I first see her. She's growing like pfft.
My biggest gripe with the art is, without a shadow of doubt, its backgrounds. And I know some of you might ask, why? They're nice, they're detailed, and the characters often interact with the environment. And you're correct, and I love that, and it does indeed deserve props. So thank you for mentioning that, guy I just made up. Yes, the backgrounds are indeed nice. They look great. There's cool establishing shots of a lot of environments, so you really get to feel the creativity behind the places, which is important in a fantasy setting where the world is so different. How fucking ever. As the comic goes on, more and more characters start talking about how they want to see the skies, the stars, the sun, and what have you, when they reach the top of the tower. Why? What's wrong with these clouds that you see right here? How about the light you got emitting from the sky right now? You wanna see stars like the specks of lights in the night sky here? Now people might say that they obviously wanna see the real deal, and I get that. Well, maybe except for the clouds, cause fuck you, these are obviously clouds. But other than that, yeah, I get it. The problem is, however, that this wish, this desperate wish, this drive for several characters is being betrayed by the art. The whole wish constantly feels redundant when you're reading the comic because they got everything they say they want right there in so many of the comic scenes. Why not completely remove the clouds? Why not have the nighttime be unreasonably dark? Why not have every scene taking place outside being oddly colored to show their light is fake? You know, do stuff to enforce the idea that they are inside a tower and are longing for freedom. Or heck, even do the anime trope and have the character reach out for the sun as they always do for some reason, but then have the character snap out of it and you didn't see what they were reaching out for was some sort of electrical spotlight or something. I mean, you got such a great reason to do this too, considering Bam has never seen the sun. Do anything to visually show why they're longing for something and how they're being denied it from inside the tower, because as it stands now, what's being said and what is being shown is in drastic conflict with one another.
It's like watching some fat fuck just mowing down hamburger after hamburger after hamburger, just scream out, "Oh, I'm so hungry! Oh, why won't anyone give me any food?"
All in all, The Art of Tower of God is not bad, and I'd be lying if I said I didn't come away with it with a positive feeling. I loved its play of colors and how big and epic it could sometimes make various scenes and attacks look, even if they typically held back with the need to keep the rating down. Every character has their own unique color palette that really sticks with you, and I just have to say white and blue to whoever has read the comic and they'll know exactly what character I'm talking about. That being said, however, it is art that leaves a lot to be desired. It is truly nice to see how Zeevkesly improves as the comic goes along, and it does start out pretty strong already at the beginning. But where Zeevkesly might be able to make good art for the sake of driving a plot forward, they don't have good art when it comes to enforcing the plot. The presentation is often lacking, they keep a lot of the comics safe, and they seem to have a long way to go in terms of visual storytelling. But knowing Tower of God is only one of the series, I can't wait to see if this is something Zeevkesly will learn how to do in the long run.
I do want the best for this comic, I seriously do, but it has a long way to go.
Wow, is there a lot of characters to talk about? Like, there's a ton of these in here, and I gotta give props, that's really cool to see, you know? It kinda makes me think of a shonen manga like Bleach or Naruto or Dragon Ball, where you'd have this huge array of characters, some being good, some being evil, and some being just funny side characters. And I always think it tells a lot about people who their favorite is. It's kinda like seeing what kind of character people play in fighting games. Are they the guy who wants to be the protagonist? Do they wanna have something pretty to look at? Do they wanna look stylish as fuck? Do they wanna be funny? Do they wanna be the weird guy? Do they wanna bring the hype? Do they wanna win by any means necessary? Or do they beat their wife? So, because Tower of God has so many characters, I'm gonna simply talk about a handful of characters that I found interesting and characters I feel kinda encapsulates the characters as a whole. And obviously, we're gonna start out with Bam. Bam is... Actually, let's do things a little different this time. Let's take the protagonist and put him at the very end. Let's instead talk about Kuhn. Kuhn first starts out as a character that seems to be dubious in nature and quite the manipulator. It's clear from the get-go, he's supposed to be the cunning one, as he's often the guy who will explain why they're doing what they're doing, and he always seems to be 3 steps ahead of the competition when it comes to mind games. But woefully fast, Kuhn seems to lose a lot of his personality. He still maintains his brain and him being ahead of others, and even keeps the whole thing about him being hard to read. But any and all character he was set up to have just dissipates the further you go in. Kuhn at first seems to be the kind of guy who will use and abuse people to serve his own goals, which would act as a great constant threat to have looming in the background considering how gullible his teammate Bam is. But just a mere 2 tests later and Kuhn is just a huge massive Bam fanboy, despite Bam not really doing a whole lot to earn it. I think Bam displays his happiness in being in a group with Kuhn like maybe once or twice, and that's enough for Kuhn to just completely throw away his own goals, character, and will throw others under the bus as long as he'll succeed. Nowhere is this more obvious than when Kuhn will actively spend 6 years carrying around some girl who can't walk just cause that's what Bam would have wanted. Like, where the fuck does this friendship come from? Kuhn from the get-go shows he's the kind of guy who will use people as long as they're useful to him, but then discard them the moment they've served the purpose. So what the hell is this shit now? Seriously, he's like a completely different character, and this isn't like growth or him evolving. I mean, shit, if he's indeed 400 years old, he should be well past developing his personality. But even then, it happened so fast. We don't see him and Bam bonding beyond just helping each other get past the test, and this is enough for Kuhn to wanna handicap himself for 6 years in servitude to this guy? Fucking what?
Plus, all of his genius tricks and strategies always just boils down to, Yeah, while you weren't looking, I basically bullshitted my way to victory. Because I just filled this entire room with Chekhov's guns. I know it's an important thing with a Chekhov's gun that you establish the gun, but we don't really know how a Chekhov gun works here in the tower. Either that, or I just kinda did something that was never established it was a thing in this universe. I'm cool, I don't give a fuck.
Next up is Androsi Jahad. So Androsi is one of the princesses of Jahad, and before we continue, I guess I should bring up that there's kind of a clash in how you spell the king's name, so some people says it's Sahad. I'm just using Jahad cause that's what the comic told me, so I don't really got any horse in the race. You can pick whatever you prefer, I really don't care. Anyway, Androsi is another 300 year old who has decided to climb the tower. It is again not told to us in the comic she's this old, I once again had to go on the goddamn wiki to find this information. Androsi too has a weird thing with changing her personality drastically when it comes to BAM. Normally she's what I call a loner and being fine with it. She's a vegetarian and kinda haughty in that she'll typically talk shit about people she doesn't like to get a rise out of them, and like Kuhn, doesn't seem to wanna necessarily team up with people unless they can serve her needs. But again, just like Kuhn, this changes when she gets exposed to BAM so much so that she's willing to sabotage an entire test just to help him. Maybe it's because she falls in love with BAM, and I wouldn't put that past her, not because of how her character is written, but because of how Seo writes their women. I'm not gonna say every woman, but a vast majority of the women in this comic all seem to just wanting to be with guys. The vast majority of what Androsi says when she's first introduced is about how she dates guys and how BAM isn't up to her standards. Serena Rinnan is clearly hitting on the character Shibli So over and over again. Yang Goseng has a thing for the character Kang Ho Yang, and Yun Yiwa has her being in love with BAM being the driving force of most of her character when we first meet her and over 60 chapters in from there. I'm not saying it's not fine to have your character being in love with someone, but this is Sakura from Naruto levels of character. Like their only personality and driving force is being head over heels for a guy who hardly even knows they exist.
And just like Sakura, it doesn't make for an interesting character.
Let's talk about Rack. Turtle, 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 please God put turtle on a t-shirt, turtle, it's his thing, he says turtle, 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 turtle. Let's talk about Jiang Wanyang, who is the protagonist of part 2 of Tower of God, which I will say I like. Jia is for one thing infinitely more charismatic and interesting a person to follow than BAM, but I also just like switching narrative to show what other people who are familiar with the tower and how it works and get an interesting insight in, oh right, they don't do that. We just taint to Jia and the literal only thing we get is that he's a better character. I actually think he's kind of like the best thing of the three people in BAM's team put into one. He's scheming like Kuhn, hot-headed like Rack, and determined like BAM. So these three characters put together actually does make for one interesting one, which I found really interesting. Another thing I found interesting is his name, and let me just bring the whole thing back to what I was talking about at the beginning about having to go through the comments of the page to change to the next page. Some fucking cunt decided to spoil the entire thing and, oh by the way, if you don't want this thing spoiled, skip ahead a minute or two. His name spelled backwards is Nang Wang Ya, which translates to I am Prince.
Game. Blouses.
No, not that prince. I wish, but no.
Next up is a character I'll bet my whole asshole that you didn't think I'd actually bother bringing up, and that in itself is a testament to how bad the character is. I will bet most of you who have read this comic have to this point even forgotten about this dude and his name. So let me shine a big freaking spotlight on Ho here. That's literally his name, by the way, and I'll be damned if I can remember a single solitary time a character said it. So I'm just gonna spoil what happens to Ho and touch on why after the fact. When the regulars, the participants, reach the second floor, here they basically have a whole bit where they have lessons to use their powers and strengths and shit. And I could be sat here pondering why, cause it basically identical to having an exam and your teacher teaches you what you'll need for the exam during it. But the video's gone on for long enough, so I'll give it a pass. Ho apparently had everyone he knew killed by a Ranger. Why? Who? When? Who gives a fuck? During this whole school thing, Ho realizes that Bam is really good at doing the magic thing. So much so that he finds it so unfair that Bam is so much better than him that he's willing to punish Bam by proxy by holding Rachel at knife point with the intent of making her fail a test. This doesn't work, however, and so Ho kills himself.
I honestly feel like crying. No, not because this is sad or anything. No, just because this is fucking retarded.
The leaps in actions and logic here is goddamn astounding. I'm a graphical design technologist with a Discord with some of the most talented people I have ever seen in terms of art. This would be like me wanting to commit suicide every time I saw someone do a sick art piece I could never do. And it's so poorly handled. You don't get to see any sort of real escalation. The first time you see Ho reacting to Bam's power, he's a little annoyed at best or taken back by it. And it's so poorly handled. You don't get to see any sort of real escalation. The first time you see Ho reacting to Bam's power, he's a little annoyed and taken back by it at best. And then the next thing we see, he's smiling evilly because he has the chance to dump Bam because he's better. And even then, there were better ways of making him dump him than threatening to kill someone. Say he's a drug addict, say he touched your butt. Fuck, you could make Bam back out by just yelling at this whiny bitch loud enough. And then you get found out and you immediately, and I do mean immediately, jump to, well, fuck this, guess I better kill myself. And the reason why I can so freely spoil this is because who actually gives a fuck? Ho dies and people just look kinda shocked as they can with these faces anyway. The test goes fucking on! And then afterwards, a chapter is spent on them being a little miffed. And then we right back to the status quo after that. Ho fucking who? This review has gone on for long enough, so let me finally talk about Bam. First of all, I'll be first to admit I don't know what the shit is up with his name. Like the 35th night, whatever happened to Jim, Carl, Benny, Rebecca, hey, I don't judge. I know these are all American names, but I'm also well aware I'm butchering all these Korean names, so you'll just have to pick your poison, I guess. Bam is maybe my least favorite character here, because there's nothing here. He's awkward and he wants the best for Rachel, that's it. Bam is hardly even a character, really. He never does something that is so typically Bam you can point at it and go, yo, that's such a Bam thing, because, well, Bam is only as good as the characters he gets to react off of. He is the straight man of the group. He's a timid bastard when meeting new people, but incredibly courageous when he has to fight monsters. He's wishy-washy with his actions until he has to do something big and he's super determined. He flip-flops all over the place and it all seems to come from him having to be what the comic needs him to be. Like, the kid's good at magic and he's ultimately strong-willed, but where's his character? If you had Bam travel up the tower alone, you wouldn't get anything cause he needs people to bounce off of. And frankly, for one of the comic's main protagonists, that's incredibly poor. And I don't get it. Jar is good. He's fine. See, you can make characters. So what the hell happened with Bam?
I swear, if you tell me, oh, that's a Wikipedia page that explains all that, I'm just gonna fucking shoot myself right here, right now.
When push comes to shove, these characters are terrible. I picked these characters because I feel they kinda encapsulates all the other characters to an extent. You got the cool calm one that always seems to be one step ahead and knowing more than they lead on. You got the goofy character that's just there to raise the mood. You got the protagonist who's mostly just there so we can follow someone as the comic goes forward. You got the female character cause a comic for teens needs to have a girl and preferably someone they can hook up with if possible. All the important ones are also weirdly overpowered all the time, but that's beside the point. And then you got the dumb, easily discardable characters that's only there to cause melodrama. All these characters are, and I'm saying this fully well knowing how much of a teenage girl I sound, so freaking basic. Like, this guy, Laura, he's really good at magic and he sleeps a lot. Shib's a goofy character who knows karate. Hatsu's a kid who's stoic and good with a sword. Like, this is all you can say about these characters. Naruto characters are fleshed out more than this.
Fucking give me something! Anything! I should not be able to sum up your character with a single fucking sentence!
The writing is a 5. It's okay. It's that weird thing where you turn your brain off and you just have fun with it. If you dare to think, however, the experience is ruined. The art is a 6. The art is good, I like to think every now and then see you whips up some great stuff, but with how many times I couldn't tell what was going on and how poorly stuff was presented in general, I can't give it a higher score than this even though I want to. The characters are A3. There's plenty to choose from, but they are also freaking shallow and boring and surface level. All in all, this comic is a 5. Like I said, I'll still suggest you go read this comic if you got any interest in stupid stuff you can turn your brain off to. Cause if you do, it give you constant entertainment all the way up. If not, give this a pass, there's better webtoons to read.
I think the issue with this comic mainly lies with the fact that it's almost like Warcraft, in that it cannot withstand being analyzed. If you read the comic and you turn your brain off, it's a good read. But if you are like me and just cannot turn this fucking thing off, it is a miserable reading experience. So if you're one of those people who can turn your brain off and enjoy something, then by all means, go read Tower of God. I'll see you guys in the next webcomic relief. Take care till next time. Coming up, I'm coming up. Feel the rush, I feel the rush. This ain't legendary, what you call it? I said, if this ain't legendary, what you call it? Feel the vibe, I feel the vibe. Extra live, I'm extra live. And I don't need improvement. Fell asleep, a man woke up superhuman. Tension thick enough to cut it with a knife. The pressure building like it's trying to bust a pipe. Chaos don't take a day off, lot of wrongs to right. I was built for the hustle, hard work and late nights. Oh no, they never seen a force like this. 5 fingers balled up in a 1 firm fist. So if history is written by the victor, then leave blank pages with a space for my picture. Cause this is what I live for, let's go. Coming up, I'm coming up. I feel the rush, I feel the rush. If this ain't legendary, what you call it? I said, if this ain't legendary, what you call it? Feel the vibe, I feel the vibe. Extra live, I'm extra live. And I don't need improvement. Fell asleep, a man woke up superhuman.
Okay, okay, okay. Hi. Missed me? I missed you guys. Wow, okay. So, I've had a pretty rough start to 2019. Let me just put that right out there, right away. So you're probably wondering, like, why has this video taken so long to do? Well, first of all, the comic was fucking long, and it took me a while to get enough to actually, you know, warrant a review. And like I stated in the beginning of the video, I honestly wanted to do Dominic Deacon instead of this one, but that didn't pan out. So I actually had to scrap that and move on to this one. But other than that, there's been a bunch of bullshit, and I'm just gonna touch on that real quick. First of all, my computer died. Basically, what happened was that my motherboard was fried. It kept shutting down, booting back up, shutting down, booting back up. And it would come at, like, complete random. Like, there was no heads or tails in the reason for it. And I sent it to the shop, and they gave me a new hard drive, and it was like, hey, yeah, okay, now it should work. And it didn't. But the new hard drive was the one where I had all of my, well, most of my YouTube stuff on. So that got lost because they had to format the hard drive to make it a boot drive. Then I sent it back in again, and they found out that it was the motherboard, and they changed that. And then while repairing it, I guess some of my RAM must have gone fucked. So I'm back down to like half the RAM that I had before. So that's been great. That halted the entire process like nuts. Other than that, I've had like my final exams and shit. You're now talking with a straight A student. I've only gotten A's, like 3 A's out of 3 exams, so I'm pretty happy about that. But that's, you know, you don't care about that. And of course, I've started my internship now, and I've started working as an actual graphical designer. So if any of you want any graphical design, hit me up on the mail. It's right here. But yeah, that's basically what's been going on. So I'm sorry for the wait. I hope it was worth the wait. And hey, you know, nothing is so bad that it's not good for anything. So because that I lost so many files, I figured why not just, you know, change things up. So I hope you like the new, like, title card things and the final verdict stuff. If there's anything you want to change or any suggestions, please let me know. Other than that, there is one thing I want to talk about, and that is that next weekend, Saturday, we will be holding another Jello Cartello stream. It's been a while since we had one of those, and we figured why not do it there. We actually planned on doing it this week, but yeah. It didn't go through. So we're doing it next week. The time will be in the description, as always. And yeah, I hope to see you guys there. It will be the second time we visit this particular project. So I think it will be a good one. Oh, one more thing. I've started a new show called Show and Tell. It is a show where I talk about visual storytelling and show examples on visual storytellings. It's basically a chance for me to really, you know, go nuts. Not do all these jokes, just basically make a video essay of showing stuff. And if you are any sort of creator, I think you would benefit greatly from that. So there will be a recommended video thing at the end of this video. Or you can just, you know, find it on my channel. But please go check it out. I've worked real hard on it, and I'm really proud of it. But enough about my trials and tribulations. It's time to go into the amazing people who have helped backed up this episode and make it so that I can actually pursue my goal of becoming a graphical designer and entertaining you guys. Thank you so much. Please go check out these comics. Please go throw some money in their direction if they're doing commissions. Just please give them the love they deserve, because they really do.
Nicholas Knudson. Nicholas wants me to push the YouTube channel called FishStickOnAStick. It's a channel that does roast reviews and readings of Creepypasta, so it's basically what you'd get if you mixed Nightmine with the webcomic Relief. So check it out. Amocin. Amocin is working on a comic called Druids, which is a mature themed fantasy comic in the world of Warcraft. If you are interested in a more mature story from that world, and done by someone who actually knows how to write, check it out. Nana Newcomb. Nana is working on the webcomic called Blackbird and Miss Murder. This is a different spin on the whole superhero comics, with two girls with psychic powers fighting crime and staying alive. If this sounds right up your alley, by all means, please go check it out.
Moron has sold his soul. Moron is doing commissions right now. So if you are standing there and you could use some, you know, art for your Valentine or anything, then you could possibly get Moron to do it for you. please check him out. You can check him out on Twitter. There will be a link for that in the description.
Hitori the artist. Hitori is doing commissions right now. So if you want some, let's say, more adult-oriented Valentine work for your significant other, then check him out. Rojaru. Rojaru wants me to push his friend Zeevkesly, who is currently living in Japan but is raising money to move to America. They sell enamel pins, stickers of their designs, and has or will open commissions for tattoos or just normal commissions. The link is in the description. The Bonsai. Bonsai is working on a fantastic comic that I've had the pleasure of sitting down with him and help with on the sidelines. Seeing how thoroughly this guy works with this comic is an absolute treat, and I can't wait till you guys finally get to see it. Follow Bonsai on his social medias to keep track of when his comic drops. Shane Asher. Shane is working on the webcomic called The Strays. The Strays is a webcomic about superhero anthropomorphic animals who fight crime. If this is something right up your alley, then by all means, please go check it out. And also a huge shout out to Henry Vault, Lariokun, Sebastian Vanborg, K.H. Raphael, Kathy Catlin, Neo, Alex J, Jordan Burke, Stacy Pitt, Kawai Lee, Shiv, and Draker of Adrian. And also a super huge thank you to all the lovely people that you see here. If you want to support the show, change my life, and make it so I can live off of YouTube and entertaining people, please go to my Patreon. Here you can donate anything you want every month, and you will get a ton of awesome rewards for it. Just go to www.patreon.com/riser2eyes. There will be a link in the description. You can also go to TeePublic and get your hands on some of the new webcomic relief merch. There's also a link for that in the description. And if you don't want to support the show financially, at least think about liking the video, subscribing to the channel, or sharing your favorite webcomic relief episode with your friends. I'll see you guys at the next webcomic relief. Take care.